In Resistance Fall of Man exists a late-stage version of the simple hybrid we see throughout. Liken it to being an elderly of their species, this particular being stalks certain areas and is considered highly dangerous. However, even with this ferocity and deadly abilities, they are very seldom seen. We are, of course, talking about the Greyjacks today and their brief existence on Earth. So with that set up, let's jump into the lore and morphology behind the Greyjacks in Resistance Fall of Man. Much like your elderly standard human being, Greyjacks appear much more lean and lanky. Seeing as they are near the end, this is pretty fitting that they have taken on this particular appearance. But considering their human origins, this is to be expected. Greyjacks stand much taller than your average human, or even hybrid for that matter. While hybrids stand at a little over 6 feet tall, a Greyjack towers over most creatures on the battlefield. Judging by their slumping posture whenever they chase you, as they can actually reach down to you, I would put these creatures at around 10 to 12 feet tall. That comes out to 3.048 to 3.6576 meters tall. A fairly sizable creature with a commanding presence on whoever it would meet in combat. One thing should be noted about this creature, however. In the battles that take place on Earth, we see specific forms that are much larger than humans, yet they would presumably have the weight to match as well. The Greyjacks, however, is a combined weight of one human. Maybe a little more considering bone density, but I wouldn't put it at a ridiculous amount higher. The reason for this is that the Greyjacks have something that is called indeterminate growth. Indeterminate growth is seen in animals throughout the animal kingdom, but snakes have it completely on lock. As a snake ages, the one thing that stops their growth is death. Due to this being the case, snakes can get to ridiculous sizes as long as they are successful hunters and able to essentially live out a long life. That is the same with the hybrids. When a hybrid is formed, it is clear that some form of the DNA from the pure chimera affects the human DNA, imprinting the growth process. As we all know, humans grow in their life clearly, but after about their 20s, this growth is done. The growth plates specifically in our body begin to harden, and at that point, we are no longer growing anymore, and our bones essentially stay what they are before deteriorating as we get older. But prior to our bone deterioration, our bones harden, and this is about the height that we will remain, which allows us to settle in and fortify these bones for the long road ahead, or hopefully the long road ahead. This is what our meat suits are designed by nature to do. However, with the interference of chimeric DNA, this changes everything. Hybrids will continue to grow throughout their lives, but this poses quite a few issues for them that are actually less than beneficial. During the early stages, it appears that the technology was not as refined as during the later points in the war, or really, the resistance. Anyways, due to that being the case, the hybrids would suffer some ill effects. Going back to my first video, we know that hybrids have incredibly fast metabolisms that aids in combat and helps them heal from damage. However, this metabolism is much a hand up as it is a knife in the back. The metabolism puts a massive burden on the body as it generates a ton of heat, so much so, in fact, that the hybrids have to have cooling units directly fused into their bodies to even stay alive. This prevents the cells from cooking outright, allowing them to survive and continue its fight against humanity. This technology seems like a quick and dirty version rather than a long-term goal in mind. Sort of a get the ball rolling scenario and we will worry about stopping it later. The cooling units will eventually begin to degrade with time, becoming less and less effective. It is a double-edged sword as well, because as the cooling units become less effective, the body continues to grow. This means that the cooling unit does its job even less. Eventually, a tipping point is reached in the chimera and hybrid body. Should it survive long enough, things begin to turn south for it. The body begins to lengthen and the creature becomes more frail looking. Eventually, the cooling pack seems to not even be functional. One of the interesting things is that it does put a lifespan on the hybrids. They can eventually be game-ended by natural causes. So why doesn't humanity just wait it out? Well, the hybrids are smart. I believe this is why they begin to terraform Earth. It is likely a terraform or die scenario, as it is with really most animals. This is why we actually don't see Greyjacks later in the games. Earth is no longer as warm, and due to this stage of life is avoided by the Chimera and Hybrid. Greyjacks simply exist in the first game because their cooling units are overtaxed, and as such, their bodies begin to succumb to their own metabolisms. In Resistance 2 and 3, however, the ambient air temperature is at a low enough temperature that the cooling units still effectively keep their body temperature in check, allowing them to remain hybrids and even larger organisms later on. Anyhow, enough of that side tangent. Essentially, a lack of competent technology by Chimeran standards, Chimeran biology, and Earth's temperatures all come together to form this disgusting creature. But why am I referring to them as disgusting? Well, strap in, because we are about to learn some facts about the Greyjacks that you might not have known due to the graphical limitations of the mid-2000s. The Greyjacks are decaying. See? We are learning already. Their literal flesh is beginning to decompose inside of their bodies due to the increased temperatures, more than likely starting from the inside and working its way out, which is to be expected. They have a nougat of decaying biomatter at their center. Ironically, the same thing that is taking them out is more than likely replacing the dead flesh with new living cells. cells, but this in turn produces more heat, which in turn kills more cells. This causes a pattern of unsustainability, which eventually will end in the death of the Greyjack. However, it is a slow process due to their ability to heal, so they have plenty of time to hunt you down. Hybrids do not typically regard Greyjacks as soldiers, and they are rarely seen in combat or scenarios where they would face gunfire. Instead, hybrids typically just ignore them. However, these creatures are death omens should any get close to you, and strangely, not in the way you might think. I mean, sure, they have like the claws, and we will get to that momentarily, but one of the dangers of these creatures comes from its natural decaying body. First, they smell absolutely awful. Reeking of the scent of decay, it could easily cause soldiers to recoil in disgust, and maybe even make them lose their lunch. This could, in theory, also have psychological effects, as deeply ingrained in our minds, we are supposed to avoid death and disease, or risk treading down that path ourselves. This is another advantage the Greyjack has, disease. It is stated that soldiers injured by this creature usually succumb to their wounds, not by bleeding or injury, but by simply an infection. The microbes on or in this creature's body are plentiful as they feast on the buffet of decaying tissue. Usually, a creature at this state wouldn't be up and walking around so damage couldn't be done, but with the Greyjack, it is able to slash at humans, causing pretty deep injuries. These injuries will fester quickly as bacteria is transferred into the living person. Due to the depth of these injuries, a blood infection becomes a very real issue. The person would more than likely go into septic shock within a few hours, leading to their expiration. So, you're skulking around deep within some military facility. The stench of decay hits your nose, and you see something tall and lanky. A lot like Slender Man, actually. As it emerges from the pod, what do you see? Well, first and foremost, you see a creature approaching you screaming at a high rate of speed. Due to this increased height, it has yielded longer legs, and as such, your stubby shorter legs, by comparison, are not going to be able to outrun this creature more than likely. Next, you'll probably see those claws. So, I am switching it up on this one. Y'all get ready? Starting with the hands, these things are massive. More than likely 18 inches in length, they are tipped with spindly fingers, and those tipped with razor-sharp claws. What makes these claws so devastating is the slash attack. To quote Archimedes, if you had a big enough lever, you could move the world. Due to the length of the arms and hands, these claws slice through the air at a ridiculous rate of speed, annihilating anything caught in front of it. The forearms of the Greyjacks have been lengthened to probably the length of an entire human regular arm. These arms still sport visible muscle, but it has become more stretched. The body would clearly need to have kept up, but one issue has been the ligaments and tendons, and these arms almost curl in somewhat, indicating that there is quite a bit of tension from the forearms on the wrists. Heading back to the bicep and tricep region, we see it looks a lot like the forearms. The muscle is stretched to maximum tensile strength, but may have the added effect that any small contractions within the muscle pull very hard, aiding in the slashing ability. The skin appears to almost be ripping on the sides, but it is still, for the most part, intact. The feet of the Greyjack sport only 3 toes, which is to be expected, as this is what the hybrids have. What is strange, however, is that the Greyjacks appear to walk on their toes, rather than the plantigrade foot that the humans have. This is more than likely due to the fact that the foot has lengthened, and it has become no longer feasible to walk on the foot. More so, since the toes have begun to lengthen, and have provided another flat surface to walk on. Continuing up the calves, we see that they are much like the forearms. The calves are stretched to almost maximum capacity, almost to the point of tearing. They almost kind of remind me of the Revenants from Doom, actually. The knees seem to be in their normal form, which is odd considering that most of the bone seems to be growing, although it is possible that the growth plates in the legs and arms are just reactivated upon becoming the hybrid and not the actual bone itself. Tubes run throughout the body, perhaps to help with the heat sinking, but it does not appear as though this was an effective solution to the problem. The quadriceps and the arms are most heavily altered by these tubes, stemming from the cooling unit. The pelvis of the creature is bony and sinewy. An outline of the pelvis is very clearly seen just under the skin. The abdomen of this alien is stretched out as clearly the vertebrae in the back began to elongate. Really not too surprising, considering everything else is, well, elongating. But then we come to the torso. The torso appears to be heavily influenced by the cooling unit. In this area, the unit seems to at least be working somewhat, as the torso is actually maintaining its relatively normal proportions. The shoulders have lengthened laterally a bit, but again, due to the influence of the heat sinking system, they seem relatively normal. Cooling unit has become somewhat completed. Usually there is a yellow color on the units, perhaps holding the fluid necessary to keep them cool. On the Greyjacks, however, it has gone completely dark, indicating either it has not switched on or it is completely empty. Perhaps these issues could be negated if the units were refueled or repowered, but it's also entirely possible that since these things are plugged into the hybrid's body, removing it to repair it would create a grievous wound that they couldn't even survive. So, once their cooling unit is done, so are they. Again, this could be rectified later in the war, as no Greyjacks are seen past the invasion of the UK. The head is is another interesting portion, and it actually shows that the creature is aging somewhat. Not seen in-game too well due to graphical issues, the eyes are a much dimmer yellow, in fact, almost appearing like cataracts somewhat. They have a grayish yellow coloring. All the proportions are the same as with the hybrids, which says to me that the growth plates in the limbs are highly influenced by the chimeran DNA and subsequent heat from their metabolism. One thing that does appear to have grown on the head is the teeth. The teeth appear several inches in length longer and are absolutely deadly should anyone get close. Overall, the grayjack is a tall, slender creature who may appear frail but is actually able to lift a full-grown soldier off the ground with ease. They are decaying on the inside, but due to their increased healing factor, they are able to survive this process for a limited amount of time. This decay has also led to an almost biological weapon that can be used against humans at will via long, sharp claws. Each step forward is about 3 of your average man, meaning that it can cover ground much faster than you. However, strangely, they are never seen in combat. This could possibly be due to the fact that since they are in this state, they could be somewhat feral, and the hybrids do not want them attacking friendly troops instead of the enemy, which holds some water considering in the later games we actually do see feral chimera. So I hope you guys enjoyed this video going over the grayjacks from Resistance Fall of Man. If you did, then please give it a like as it helps the algorithm pick up the video, and if you are new, subbing is a great way to stay caught up with the channel. Alright, so I am sold on SCPs. I watched a couple videos last night, super interested, so expect breakdowns of that in the future. Also, I have a streaming channel called Roanoke Streaming where I will post all my old live streams, but I will still stream on Roanoke Gaming, so you'll still get notifications of that. So kind of keep an eye out for that. I will link it in the description. I will also link my Twitter, Discord, and Patreon. Patreon is a great way to support the channel if you enjoy these videos. And speaking of Patreon, I would like to thank my patrons. At the scientist tier, we have Arulam Lupe. Then we got your boy, Bowen Goodwin. Next up is Artyom Chiornij. And last but not least, we have It's Not a Spoon. Our residents are A. Laurentis, Greater Genes 83, Oz Hickman, and Richard Muhlenberg. Our geneticists are Allison Caspero, Andrew Lawson, Divine Whisper, Laffy Noskill, and Steve N. With their master's biology, we have Adam Hartswick, Brendan Brotherton, Cameron Smith, Edgy McGee, Scott Grant, the Rinalize, and the Otter Man. And last but not least, with their bachelor's in morphological sciences, we have Ahigao Comics, Alex the Gun Guy, Anthony Charles West, Anthony Wolf, Captain Gasmask, Dustin Ellis, Eric Scott Gillies, Jims, Professor Binnips, Riot, Russell McBride, and the original Fats. We'll go with that. Classic. Thank you guys. Like I said, I'll link the second channel if you're interested. SCPs are coming. Lots of other games too, just so you know, I just gotta get to them first. But thank you guys for watching, and I will see y'all in the next one.